We sure do love Nazis. Let me rephrase that. Some of us, an alarmingly vocal and influential segment of us, sure do love Nazis. The rest of us love to hate Nazis, which is, as it should be, the only thing Nazis are fit for, is being hated. That's probably why, in the decades since they were driven from power and defeated the first time, they've proven to be such durable villains in our popular fiction. Nazis have shown up repeatedly in Star Trek, sometimes literally, as in the original series episode Patterns of Force. That's the episode where a Federation cultural observer transforms the planet Echos into a Nazi planet on purpose, but more often allegorically. The most effective stand-ins for the real Nazis in Star Trek have been the Cardassians, who were introduced in Star Trek The Next Generation and became one of the primary antagonists in Star Trek Deep Space Nine. Deep Space Nazis! They're Nazis who live in space. Deep Space Nine features three major Cardassian recurring characters. I have already done videos about two of them, Dukat and Garak. Now, thanks to the wisdom of my Patreon patrons who responded to the most recent topic poll, the time has come to complete the trilogy by turning my attention to the third Cardassian, who plays a major role in the story of DS9. Join me, won't you, as I ponder the question, is Damar actually Star Trek's good Nazi? Unlike Dukat, who shows up as a foil for Commander Sisko in the series pilot, and Garak, who first appears as an intriguing figure of mystery in the second episode to be broadcast, Damar's introduction to Deep Space Nine is pretty low-key. He doesn't show up until halfway through the show's fourth season, in the episode Return to Grace, where we see him as a member of Gul Dukat's crew on the Cardassian freighter Grumal. By the end of that episode, Dukat, with some help from Major Kira, who was along for the ride, has captured a Klingon bird of prey. Damar joins Dukat aboard the bird of prey, and that's the last we see of him until the start of the next season. Not a very auspicious beginning for a character who will eventually become extremely important to the series. And yet, in that first appearance, the show gives us hints that, while Damar isn't a big deal yet, he will be. Even though Damar doesn't have much to do in Return to Grace, the episode's direction and editing treat him like an important character. He gets close-ups and reaction shots, and his loyalty to Dukat is established, which will turn out to be a crucial aspect of his character. Loyalty is a big part of who Damar is, we find out. His loyalty to Dukat is exceeded only by his devotion to Cardassia. When Dukat orchestrates Cardassia's entry into the Dominion with himself installed as leader of Cardassia, Damar is supportive both because he's Dukat's dependable right-hand man and also because he believes Dominion membership will make his beloved Cardassia strong again. But Damar doesn't really like the Dominion. He doesn't trust the Jem'Hadar or the Vorta or the Founders. He doesn't seem to trust anybody really, except his fellow Cardassians. Ultimately, Damar is forced to choose between his personal loyalty to Dukat and his nationalistic loyalty to Cardassia. At the end of DS9's fifth season, Dominion forces led by Dukat drive out Starfleet and take control of the station. Then, in the sixth episode of Season 6, Sacrifice of Angels, Captain Sisko leads a fleet of starships back to DS9 and, with some help from the Prophets, retakes control of the station. As the Cardassians are abandoning Deep Space Nine, Dukat's daughter, Zial, reveals that she has been helping Major Kira and others plot a resistance against Cardassian Dominion rule. Damar overhears this and does to Zial what he thinks any patriotic Cardassian ought to do when faced with a traitor. He kills her. And he turns to Dukat like, "Did I do a good job, boss?" And Dukat goes, "No, you killed my daughter." And Damar's like, "Your treasonous daughter? Now, come on, let's blow this Jum'Jah stick stand before Starfleet gets here." And Dukat's like, "Leave me alone, I'm descending into madness." His split from Dukat is a turning point for Damar, so let me leave him there for a moment, because I want to talk a little about what I mean by the term good Nazi. I discussed this idea a bit in the Garak video, so briefly, and hopefully without repeating myself too much, a good Nazi in this context is a person who is or has been a Nazi, but who finds themselves fighting against the Nazis. Sometimes they retain their standing and work to thwart the organization secretly from within. Sometimes they renounce their Nazi membership and join an opposing group. The details vary from story to story, but one thing almost all good Nazis have in common is a love of their country. They join the Nazi Party because they believe it will make Germany strong, or because they're already part of some other respected German institution, like the military. And when the Nazis rise to power, they don't really have any other choice but to support them. Eventually, they realize the Nazis aren't what they signed up for. Maybe they become aware of the atrocities being committed. Maybe they lose confidence in the leadership of Hitler and his inner circle. And the same love of country that compelled them to join the Nazis now drives their efforts to see the Nazis defeated. Broadly speaking, that's Damar. He's a proud Cardassian. He serves the Cardassian state as a member of the military. He admires the strength of the authoritarian regime that rules Cardassia and enjoys benefits as an agent of that regime. And he doesn't seem the least bit guilty about the occupation of Bajor, which, in case you forgot, is Star Trek's version of the Holocaust. But when Dukat is captured after Starfleet retakes DS9, Damar takes his place as leader of Cardassia under Dominion authority. And it's not long before Damar realizes that the Dominion doesn't have the best interests of his beloved Cardassia at heart. At first, he deals with this by getting drunk. But when the Dominion enters into a new alliance that includes handing over Cardassian territory to the Breen, and Dominion leader Weyoun sacrifices 500,000 Cardassian troops in order to stall the Klingons, Damar decides to take action. He forms the Cardassian Liberation Front, and with a small group of loyal military commanders, leads a rebellion against the Dominion forces occupying Cardassian territory. This is very good news to Starfleet, which, even with help from the Klingons and the Romulans, seems constantly on the cusp of losing the war. Odo, Garak, and Kira travel to the rebellion's secret base to help Damar out, and the shit really hits the fan in one of Deep Space Nine's final episodes, Tacking Into the Wind. So, thanks to the Breen, the Dominion has a new weapon that is capable of draining the energy of opposing ships, leaving them sitting ducks for attacks by the Jem'Hadar and such. Kira, who along with Odo and Garak has been trying to give Damar and his rebels terrorist lessons, proposes stealing a Jem'Hadar ship equipped with the weapon. She says, let's go to the Kelvis system and sneak into this Cardassian base where those energy dampening weapons are being installed on Jem'Hadar ships. We'll take it back to Starfleet and they can figure out how to defend against it. That seems like a good idea, only there's this one guy, Gulru Saad, an old buddy of Damar's, who has a real hard-on for Kira. He's like, you just want to kill more Cardassians. And Kira's like, what was that? Here, try saying it again while I'm choking you. And Rusat says, just so you know, when the war's over, I'm totally gonna kill you. Later, the gang is on their way to infiltrate the base in the Kelvis system when Damar gets some bad news. The Dominion has found his family. And then, after they found his family, what they did was, they killed them. Damar is like, but my family had nothing to do with the rebellion. What kind of state orders the murder of innocent people? And Kira's like, seriously? Dude, I'm a survivor of the occupation and I'm standing right here. Damar's like, I'm grieving, so nuts to you, and walks away. Kira worries that maybe throwing Damar's own history of supporting a brutal murder-sanctioning regime in his face right after the execution of his wife and son was the wrong move, but Garak reassures her that she did the right thing. Because it's true. Before turning against the Dominion, Damar was a loyal officer in service to the Cardassian Union, a nation that presided over the torture and enslavement and execution of who knows how many innocent people during the occupation of Bajor. And let's not forget that life for most Cardassians living under that government didn't seem all that great either, from what we saw of it. Garrick tells Kira that in order to become the person they need him to be, Damar will have to let go of his romanticism about the past, and hopefully the pain he feels now at the loss of his family will push him forward, not backward. Conveniently enough, Damar faces a dilemma rich with implications regarding this very issue later in this same episode. The rebels sneak into the Kelvis base and take control of a Jem'Hadar ship that's being equipped with the energy weapon. While they're waiting for installation to be completed so they can get the hell out of there, Kira and Rusat have another scuffle, and it winds up with Rusat pointing a gun at her. So Garrick pulls his gun and points it at Rusat. Damar pulls his gun too, and Rusat's like, "Yeah, come on man, get in on this. It's like we're in a Tarantino movie. Or even better, a Leone movie that Tarantino ripped off." Tarantino directing Star Trek, can you imagine anything so preposterous? Rusat says to Damar, "You shoot Garrick, I'll shoot Kira, then the two of us can take the energy weapon and use it to restore the old Cardassia, the same Cardassia we served all those years. We can put things back the way they used to be. Do you see what I'm saying? Am I making it clear what I represent? Just aim and fire." So Damar aims and fires and kills Gul Rusat. Damar says, "He was my friend, but his Cardassia is dead. And it won't be coming back." And he shares a look with Kira like, "Message received, no more innocent people murdering, okay?" And they take the ship, and yada yada yada. A few weeks later, the Federation Alliance wins the war. In my video about Garrick, I described four factors about Garrick's character as revealed and developed throughout the series that I feel make it possible for him to be redeemed. Those four factors are remorse, change, amends, and the fact that Garrick is a fictional character. Those four factors are a little more difficult to find in Damar. He seems to feel some remorse for the things he's done. It's suggested he's haunted by his murder of Zial, and after the execution of his family, he appears to grasp the magnitude of the crimes of his old regime. Damar's remorse isn't as obvious or as dramatically presented as Garrick's, but that might just be because Damar is a less expressive character. Damar definitely changes when he turns on the Dominion and leads a rebellion against it. His rebellion is crucial to turning the tide of the war, so I'd call that making amends. Plus, on a more personal level, Damar eventually lets go of his prejudice against Bajorans and accepts Kira as an ally. And finally, yeah, Damar is a fictional character, so we can afford to give him a lot more slack than we would an actual person who had done similar things. The problem is, the details of Garrick's crimes are largely left out of his appearances in the show, and Garrick is depicted from the beginning as being morally ambiguous and conflicted. He's also an enemy of Gul Dukat. Damar, on the other hand, doesn't acquire much complexity until later in his arc. He's a loyal soldier of the fascist state that is the Cardassian Union. His loyalty to Gul Dukat never entirely disappears. In fact, Damar is guilty or complicit in at least as much violence and persecution and death as Garrick, but without any of the potentially mitigating complications. And let me be clear, that doesn't mean Damar isn't a good character. I think Damar is a great character, but is he a good Nazi? Or is he just a Nazi who opportunistically switches sides when he sees things going in a direction he doesn't like? When evaluating Damar, I think we need to consider a fifth factor. Damar's redemption rests not only on his remorse, his change, his making amends, and his fictionality, but on his death. It happens in the final episode of the entire series, What You Leave Behind. Kira and Garrick are still with Damar helping out the Resistance. They're on Cardassia, and things aren't going so well. The Dominion government has responded to the Cardassian Rebellion by destroying Lakarian City, along with its 2 million inhabitants. Damar, Kira, and Garrick are captured, but they're saved from execution at the hands of the Jem'Hadar by Cardassian soldiers who turn on their Dominion allies and pledge their support to Damar and the Rebellion. In fact, it seems like the entire Cardassian military decides to turn on the Dominion and side with Starfleet, the Klingons, and the Romulans. When Weyoun tells the female changeling, who is the leader of all Dominion forces, about that, she's like, "Okay, screw this. Just wipe out the whole Cardassian population. That'll show them." So Damar, Kira, and Garrick are like, okay, so they're just killing everybody now. We should really do something to stop it. They make it to Dominion headquarters, and when some Jem'Hadar come outside with a few Cardassians to execute, the rebels attack and a big fight breaks out. During the fight, Damar is wounded. And Garrick's like, hey, Dee, you okay? And Damar goes, not really, I'm gonna die. And then he dies. Soon after that, the rebels take control of the Dominion headquarters. Kira and Garrick find Weyoun and the female changeling, and Weyoun is like, hey, where's Damar? And Garrick kills him. And the female changeling is like, man, that was my last Weyoun. Okay, so that last bit has nothing to do with Damar. I just really like it when Garrick kills Weyoun. Anyway, it's important for Damar's character that he dies, and for more than just the obvious reason. Let's briefly review Damar's character arc. He goes from a proud Cardassian nationalist, supporter of the Cardassian occupation of Bajor, and right-hand man to Gul Dukat, to the leader of Cardassia after killing Dukat's daughter, to the leader of a rebellion against the Dominion occupation of Cardassia. Pretty standard good Nazi stuff there. Leading the rebellion is good, fighting the Dominion is good, but Damar initially turns against the Dominion mainly because he doesn't like the way they're bossing the Cardassians around. He does eventually come to accept that the Cardassian Union had some pretty serious problems even before the Dominion got involved, but it costs the lives of his wife and son to get him there. And contributing to the defeat of the Dominion is a big deal, but is it big enough to erase his complicity in the Bajoran occupation or his enduring loyalty to Gul Dukat? I don't think it is, personally. It's a little bit like Darth Vader's last second babyface turn in Return of the Jedi. He saves Luke's life and chucks the Emperor into that shaft, which is a big deal, but does that make up for all the evil shit he's done up to that point, including participating in the destruction of Alderaan? And if we factor in the prequels, at least two separate acts of mass murder, killing the entire village of Sand People in Attack of the Clones and killing all those children in the Jedi Temple in Revenge of the Sith? I don't think so. Same deal with Damar. He does a lot of good before the end, but is it enough to balance out the years of his life he spent in service to evil? I don't think it is. The only way Damar's redemption is even remotely possible is if he dies in the process. The price of that redemption is just too high not to cost Damar his life. His past sins are so egregious that while he can fight for a new Cardassia, he can't be allowed to live in it. Damar is a great character. He grows from a glorified extra into one of the most consequential people in the entire Star Trek franchise. He goes from a proud agent of fascism to a rebel against fascism, from a remorseless killer to a man shaken by the guilt of his deeds, from a soldier of unquestioning loyalty to a leader of unquestionable courage. It's one of the greatest feats of writing in all of Deep Space Nine, a show with no shortage of great writing. And don't let me conclude this video without mentioning Casey Biggs, who plays Damar and is able to sell his transformation from Dukat sidekick to pathetic drunken Dominion doormat to inspiring freedom fighter. He develops Damar into one of the most interesting characters on a show with practically nothing but interesting characters, which is no small accomplishment. But even with all of that, for Damar to truly be redeemed in the end, he has to give his life for the cause of the heroes. He has to die. That, finally, is what allows him to become Star Trek's equivalent of a good Nazi. Because, as we all hopefully know by now, in science fiction, as in real life, the only good Nazi is a dead Nazi. Hey folks, well, there's your Damar video. The trilogy is now complete. I have done videos on all three major Deep Space Nine Cardassian characters. Hope you enjoyed this one. Hope it stands up well enough to the videos I did about Dukat and Garrick. I know those are some of my most viewed and best liked Trek Actually videos, so hopefully this is a worthy addition to that little sub-series within this series. I'm going to let you know about the topics of some upcoming Trek Actually videos in a second, but first I want to give shoutouts to my newest $5 or more per month Patreon patrons. And their names are Navion, thank you Navion, Joel Cromwell, thank you, Joel. Darian Sills Evans, thank you, Darian. Kelsey Winter, thank you, Kelsey. Kevin Morgan, thank you, Kevin. Sarah Rackleff, thank you, Sarah. And Nathan Olson, thank you, Nathan. Thanks to all of you who are my Patreon patrons at whatever level you are currently pledging, however long you have been pledging for. I want to remind you that if you enjoy these videos I do, particularly the Star Trek themed videos, since this is the video you happen to be watching right now, you can support my continued production of videos on this channel by going to patreon.com/Steve Shives and becoming a patron for as little as $1 a month, but $5 a month or more gets you a shout out at the end of the Trek Actually videos. Now, as far as the next topic of the Trek Actually videos is concerned, I announced at the end of my DC Fontana video, which is the previous video in the series, that after this Damar video, I would also be doing an unscheduled, or a previously unscheduled, because it's scheduled now, video about the character of Odo in tribute to Rene Auberjonois, who passed away recently, unfortunately. So next week, there will be a Trek Actually video about Odo in tribute to Odo. And then in January, I will do a video on the topic that was selected by my Patreon patrons in the most recently completed Patreon poll. Because one of the perks of being a patron of this channel is for any amount, you get to vote in polls every month to determine future Trek Actually topics. And the topic of the next Trek Actually video that was chosen by my patrons that will come after the Odo video next week, it will come probably in the middle of January, will be on the subject of why Star Trek Enterprise actually has the worst ending ever. I've been talking a lot about Deep Space Nine lately, I feel, because I did in October, I did a special video about Nog in remembrance of Aaron Eisenberg. Just now I did a video about Damar. Next week is a video about Odo. So I've been doing a lot of Deep Space Nine stuff lately, and I'm completely okay with that. As you know, if you've been watching these videos for a while, Deep Space Nine is far and away my favorite Star Trek series. No problem whatsoever talking about Deep Space Nine. But it's nice to pay attention to other aspects of the franchise as well, because I want this to be Trek actually, not DS9 actually. So we'll do a video about Enterprise and the ending of Enterprise, probably the least loved series finale that any Star Trek show has done to date. People really, really love to hate on that Star Trek Enterprise finale, even people who really, really love Enterprise as a series overall. So we're gonna take a look at why the Enterprise finale is just so rotten and so despised, and what sorts of unfathomable creative decisions may have led to making that show as the final episode of Star Trek Enterprise, and for a while, for a few years there, as the final episode of Star Trek on TV, period, because that was the end of a long period of continuous production in Star Trek. And whew, quite a controversial way to wrap that whole era of the franchise up. I'm sure most of you would agree. So that's the next voted on Trek Actually topic, why Enterprise had the worst ending ever. That's coming in January. Next week is the special Odo video. Also, don't forget, if you like the Star Trek stuff, to listen to the Ensign's Log podcast. That is the Star Trek-themed comedy podcast that I co-host along with Jason Harding, where we play low-ranking officers serving aboard a certain legendary Federation starship as it embarks on a certain historic 5-year mission. I think you get where I'm going with this. We are deep into our second season, and things are really starting to get interesting in terms of our storylines, as well as the little asides and gags we do that are inspired by episodes of the original Star Trek series. So if you haven't listened to the Ensign's Log yet, I almost screwed up, but I didn't. I caught it, see? And then I left this bit in instead of editing it out, so you could see what a professional I am by catching myself. And I think this, I'm pretty sure not editing it out was the right choice. Anyway, if you are a fan of the Star Trek stuff that I do and you enjoy comedy at the expense of Star Trek or with a Star Trek slant to it, and you haven't listened to the Ensign's Log, check it out, because it's getting interesting, and hopefully it's funny and you enjoy it, and we certainly enjoy making it. So give a listen to the Ensign's Log. It's in the description of this video. You can listen via SoundCloud or on the website or subscribe via RSS using your favorite podcast app. Check out the Ensign's Log. That's it for me, everybody. Thank you all so much for watching. I will see you next week for the Odo video, next month for the video about the crappy ending to Star Trek Enterprise. And of course, I'll see you a bunch of times in between as well as I do other videos. So that's it. Take care, everybody. Thanks for watching.